Welcome. Thanks for spending your lunch hour with me on Friday here. Appreciate you spending the time. So we'll just to give you a little kind of outline, we're going to spend about maybe 40, 45 minutes with my lecture. And then if you have questions, feel free to just put those into the chat. And if I can pay attention, I'll try to answer them as I'm talking. But most of them will kind of hold till the end and then go over them. And Christina will come back on and she'll kind of field the questions and make sure we get those answered. If for some reason we don't get to your questions, we will make sure we follow up with you directly somehow, either through email or what have you. We'll get you an answer to your question. So, all right, without further. So we're going to talk about new Parkinson's disease medication. So if you're here for some other type of lecture, you are at the wrong place. All right, so what are our objectives? And I think these were in the email out to you, but basically to go over what the new medications are and kind of what symptoms they're supposed to improve. And then what type of patients, you know, why might you choose one versus the other? How do you know that you need these newer medications? So those are our objectives today, and hopefully we will be able to cover them. So just a quick review. This is just an overview of all of the different medications we'll be covering. There's a few more at the end, but these are the newer ones that have been out, approved by the FDA in the last 2 to 3 years or so. And most of these are actually, we're going to talk about motor fluctuations and off time as well as dyskinesia. So we'll go into that a little bit more. But most of these newer medications are addressing off time. This is the list of them. Safinamide was approved in March of 2017. We'll talk about that. Opicapone is a COMT inhibitor, FDA approved in July of 2019. So Embrija is an inhaler. We'll talk about that. FDA approved in December 2018. Apomorphine, talk about that. It was originally approved as an injectable drug in 2004 and then more recently as a sublingual medication. So we'll just talk about that as well. And then estradefylline, just recently approved in August. And then there's other medications for off time as well as dyskinesia, FDA approved in August of 2017. And then just approved in, Osmolex approved in 2018. So these are the main medications that we were covering. And as you can see, there are a lot of new things that have been approved for Parkinson's disease. So a lot of these, we have actually been fortunate to be part of the research to help to develop these drugs. So thank you all for those who have participated in the studies that have allowed these new drugs to come to market. So it's kind of exciting to realize how many new things there actually are. And as neurologists, it makes it kind of hard to figure out, which might be better for which type of patient. So we've got so many things now in our armamentarium of medications that can be used. So the first thing I want to talk about is really just a little bit of education, not so much about the drug, but just about Parkinson's itself. And that then leads into who might consider these particular medications. So we all have to get familiar with these concepts of motor fluctuations and dyskinesia. We'll talk about what they are here in just a sec, but first of all, the prevalence. So motor fluctuations are something that people don't see initially in Parkinson's disease, but they, over about a period of about 5 years, up to about half of people will start to develop motor fluctuations. And by the time you reach 10 years or so, 10 to 15 years into Parkinson's, the vast majority of people will have it. In fact, I was just reviewing a paper that really suggested up to basically about 100% of people will eventually develop motor fluctuations. So that's motor fluctuations, and then dyskinesia is the other concept. So we'll go through them. So talking about off time. So motor fluctuations is this response to medications where you feel the medication kind of kicking in and then wearing off, and then kicking in and then wearing off. And mostly what we're referring to is that levodopa that most people will take. So carbidopa, levodopa. Cinemed is the brand name, also Rytary, some of these other formulations of it. But over time, that medication starts to have a reduction in its half-life in the patient with Parkinson's, and then that is experienced as motor fluctuations. So the medication feels like it's kicking in, and then as you get closer to the end of the dose, you feel it start to wear off, and when it wears off, you feel a reemergence of Parkinson's symptoms. Sometimes that can be tremor. Sometimes it can be kind of stiffness, slowness symptoms. Sometimes it can be non-motor symptoms. Some people will feel very anxious when their medication wears off, or just feel very lethargic as their medication wears off. So that's that concept of off time. And of course, the corresponding thing is on time. When the medication is kicking in and working well, and you're moving about normally and feeling that response to the medication. So that's called on time. So off time, on time. And then the next concept is dyskinesia. So what are dyskinesias? So many of you probably aren't experiencing dyskinesia, but some of you are, and some people are experiencing it and maybe even not that bothered by it. So what are dyskinesias? So these are sort of involuntary movements that patients with Parkinson's can get with response to their medication. So as the medication kicks in, maybe about an hour or so into the dose of the levodopa, you start to develop a little bit of involuntary movements. And that's manifest as things like a little bit of swaying. I like to call it hula hooping, where you feel like your body's kind of just swaying around. Sometimes a little bit of facial movements, some facial twitching or movements there. And then occasionally it's in the arms and legs as well, where you have the movements, and it's not tremor. So tremor is this sort of back and forth type movement. These are more kind of random, kind of twisting movements that you might see. So and we divide dyskinesia then into non-troublesome and troublesome dyskinesia. So non-troublesome is probably what the vast majority of people have, where they feel, they might see, notice a little bit of kind of twisting, fidgeting type movements, but they really don't interfere with function. They're not that noticeable. Most people aren't even aware that they have them if you're a patient and they aren't that interfering. They become troublesome when they actually interfere with function. For example, you're moving so much that you can't sit still in a chair and might have trouble sitting still in the chair. So, or you're swaying so much that it's interfering with standing or walking. So then it becomes troublesome. Some people will lose a lot of weight when they're having bothersome dyskinesias because they're moving all of the time. And so that can actually be a problem if you're losing so much weight because of these involuntary movements. So most patients will find that they have some dyskinesia that isn't really that bothersome. In fact, they don't mind it because their medications are in their system, they're moving well, they're feeling good. And so a little bit of dyskinesia isn't necessarily a bad thing. And then if we move over, so those are the kind of concepts of what we're trying to address with a lot of these new medications. So if you look at the graph then on that, on the right-hand side, then you see that concept of the drug, the levodopa fluctuating in the system. And for the first, maybe 5 years of diagnosis, you're within the therapeutic window. So it's going up and down in the system, but it's still within that therapeutic window. And then as time progresses, as Parkinson's progresses, it starts to swing out into the dyskinesia, where you get the on with dyskinesia, and then down into the off time where the medications have worn off. So now we've got all of those kind of concepts in mind. People often ask, well, how do I know if I'm experiencing that? And most people will notice if they are. They start to be aware that as they get closer to the dose, they experience this end of dose wearing off. But what I encourage people to do is, if they're not quite clear, maybe they're just having periods of kind of poor functioning throughout the day and wondering whether they are actually experiencing off time, I think it's good to kind of track on a diary. And so this is an example of a diary we might use in a research study where we're studying these types of new medications, where you track, your sleep time. You're obviously not getting up to check the boxes when you're asleep, but in the morning you wake up and you put in the times when you were asleep, the times when you're feeling the off time, the times when you're feeling on, and then the times where you might be having dyskinesia. And that can allow you to just track and see, are there periods of time where maybe you're close to the dose and realizing, oh yeah, really, I am having some off time there. Or maybe you're realizing that, hey, I'm just not ever consistent with my medications and I need to be doing a better job of keeping my medications on time. And that's all I really need to do to prevent some of this on-off time. So the other thing that helps people with these diaries is figuring out if the off time might start to become unpredictable. So most of off time when it first starts is more predictable. It's right at the end of the dose. So every day if I take my medications at 7, noon, and 5, my carbidopa, levodopa, as I get to about 11 o'clock, I start to notice that I'm having a little bit more tremor. So, and that's called predictable wearing off. With time, people can start to have a little bit more unpredictability of the wearing off, where you've taken a dose and maybe an hour later, it's actually, you don't ever feel like it's kicked in. You know, it's kind of that unpredictability. You've been taking your medications, you haven't missed a dose, and it starts to be unpredictable. And so those are things you can capture in some of these diaries to try to figure out if you really are having off time that is kind of relevant and worth treating. So, all right. So you know, what are the current strategies then that we, so prior to all of these new medications, what are the available strategies to deal with off time? And so I've just put together a list of some of the things that have been available now for quite a while that we use to manage off time. And you say, well, wow, that's a pretty good list. Why do you need new medications that address that? And the basic concept is a lot of these, there are reasons why they're not perfect medications, you know, why they're not the best treatment for off time. And we'll go through that as we talk about each of these new medications of why they have an advantage, you know, potentially have an advantage over some of the older medications. So this is something we fight with the insurance companies as well as, well, why can't you use a cheap generic drug that's been around for 10 or 15 years? So arguing why to switch to one of these newer medications. So So these are some of our strategies that we use to deal with off time. You can add an extender medication. You can add a dopamine agonist type medication like Mirapex or Requip. You can simply take medication more frequently. If you take your carbidopa from 3 times a day to 4 times a day, that might be all you need to do to manage that off time. So these are the kind of strategies. Rytary is a longer acting carbidopa levodopa formulation that's been available to us for some time. And so can be switched over. So these are some of the current strategies that we use. But what we really want to talk about here is kind of focusing on the newer drugs. So before we do that, I just want to show you this kind of schematic of what we're trying to do with all of these different drugs. So here is your little dopamine neuron in the brain, this little green structure here. And that projects up to this little synapse into what's called the striatum of the brain. Where these little GABA neurons, and so these dopamine neurons are trying to send the dopamine across the synapse. So, and of course, with Parkinson's, we lose these dopamine neurons, and so we just have less dopamine available. And so all of these different drugs act in a different way to try to enhance that, the kind of healthiness of that synapse, the neurons where they kind of interact there with the brain to try to improve movement. So all of our different drugs then are really trying to facilitate this sort of communication within the brain. So that's what we're doing, and we'll talk about them actually as we go through. So, all right, so our first drug is safinamide. It's a brand name, Jidago. It is what is called a reversible MAO inhibitor. And so what does that mean? So it is a monoamine oxidase inhibitor. It blocks basically the one way that dopamine is broken down in the brain. So what it does is make dopamine hang around longer. So it works to make your levodopa last longer in the brain. So it's approved as an adjunctive therapy. So to people who are already on carbidopa levodopa therapy, and it's approved for wearing off. It comes as 50 milligrams and 100 milligrams therapy. There actually isn't a lot of difference between the two drugs, but for some reason the FDA just decided to approve both dosing of the drug. But 50 milligram is almost the same as 100 milligrams. So, and they improve on time by about half an hour at both doses. So you go, wow, that's not very much. So that's actually compared to placebo. And so if you actually compare it to just how people were at baseline before they got into the study, it does a better job than just half an hour. But what the FDA likes to look at is how does it compare to the sugar pill or how does it compare to placebo? So basically it reduces off time. So now what are the advantages of it? So we've got all these other therapies. Why might we consider this? So one is it's a fairly rapid acting MAO inhibitor. So if you look at older drugs like risagiline, for instance, that may take weeks, maybe a month or so before you actually see the full benefit of that drug. Something like safinamide can start working within just a few days. So it has an advantage there of being a little bit more rapid acting. The other reason we like it is that it also has NMDA blocking properties. And what does that mean? That means that it might actually have some potential impact on dyskinesia, so that it might actually help to reduce the dyskinesia. So the idea is if we're increasing your amount of dopamine in the brain, that might actually trigger these dyskinesias, which we kind of don't want. We don't want too much dyskinesia. So this drug is sort of a double targeted drug in the sense that it increases dopamine levels and helps that helps to reduce off time, but it also might help to reduce that side effect of the dyskinesia developing. So those are the reasons we would think about adding that particular drug. So our next one is opicapone or Gentis. It's a COMT inhibitor. And this is another drug that has a effect on off time. So it is a COMT is the other enzyme that helps to start to break down dopamine. So it breaks down levodopa. It also breaks down dopamine. And it is actually very similar to a medication called entacapone or Comtan that's been out for, I don't know, 20 years or so now. But the real advantage of this one is that it has a very long half-life, so it can be given once a day. So for those of you who are on entacapone or know it, it is a drug that has to be right now given with every single dose of levodopa. So if you're on four times a day, five times a day, you might be taking entacapone with every single dose to try to extend the duration of that dose. So this drug has a very nice advantage of reducing off time, but only given as a once a day therapy. So which is really nice if you're going to do an add-on therapy or do an adjunctive therapy. It's very nice to have something that you can just add one extra pill per day instead of five extra pills per day if you're trying to add it on to each dose of levodopa. So how it works, it helps to break down levodopa and basically keep it around longer. It is a fixed dosing. It is dosed at 50 milligrams once daily, so just once in the morning, so really nice. And this is kind of a graph on the right-hand side where you can see on the benefits of the 50 milligram opicapone compared to the placebo in terms of the reduction in off time for people. They also compared it to entacapone, which is the older drug that has to be given with each dose. And it actually has a little bit of an advantage over entacapone, so it might be a little bit more favorable drug in terms of the amount of benefit that you get with it. So another nice thing about it is the side effect profile. It seems to be pretty good. So it can increase dyskinesia because it's increasing the amount of dopamine in the body. And it doesn't have that ability to sort of block that dopamine effect. So you might see a little bit of increased dyskinesia. So for people who don't have a lot of dyskinesia, that's not a problem, but you probably wouldn't want to add it in somebody who already has a lot of dyskinesia trying to address that off time. So dyskinesia is probably the primary side effect, a little bit of constipation with it, and sometimes some dry mouth. And actually these are fairly mild side effects with it. And that's another thing that I think we see with these newer drugs is the side effect profiles are quite a bit better than some of the older drugs, which is really nice for patients too. So I think that's a nice advantage for some of these drugs going forward is that they do have better side effect profiles. So, all right, our next drug is istradefylline or Nurian. So istradefylline is quite a mouthful. It took me a long time to learn how to say that. But if you remember Nurians, and I don't know how they came up with that name, but that's the name for it. So it is an interesting drug that's been around in Japan for many years now. So it's a Japanese company that developed it. And they have been trying for a long time to get it approved in the US and just recently now have gotten it approved. So it is add-on therapy, just like many of these drugs are, and it is designed to improve off time. It doesn't seem to have a lot of benefit just by itself, and that actually has been studied with this particular drug where they thought maybe it would have some benefit by itself, but it doesn't. So it is a very novel medication. There's actually nothing else like it on the market currently for Parkinson's disease, and from that standpoint, it kind of has a really nice advantage overall. Because it's for those patients who have maybe tried everything, this is something that really is quite novel and could be considered. And how does it work? It blocks adenosine 2A receptor antagonists or A2A receptors. And what are those receptors? They're little receptors in the striatum of the brain that actually they sort of enhance the effect of dopamine in the brain. So they sort of sensitize the brain to the dopamine effect. It's an interesting thing. Caffeine is actually an adenosine 2A receptor antagonist. So although it works less specifically than this particular drug does. So this one is a little bit more specific for Parkinson's. So, and actually they've started to look, you know, does this drug actually have like an alerting or an anti-fatigue effect? And I think that that's still something that's under investigation with it. So, but we do know that it reduces off time. The dosing is 20 milligrams or 40 milligrams. 20 milligrams is usually the dose for just about everybody. Sometimes you might bump it up to 40 milligrams. If you're a smoker, you have to do 40 milligrams, which is just kind of a unique thing. So it's pretty rare that people with Parkinson's are active smokers, but for those that are, they need a 40 milligram dose. So side effects with it can worsen dyskinesia, although it seems to do it milder than just adding another type of dopamine extenders. So it does seem to have a little bit of an ability to suppress dyskinesia as well. So although that is still a side effect of this particular medication, is the potential to worsen dyskinesia. So the nice thing about it otherwise is that the other side effects are fairly minimal. So it is very well tolerated as a medication. And I like that particular aspect. So it doesn't have a lot of like neuropsychiatric type side effects, won't make you hallucinate, that type of thing. And so it seems to be pretty good from that standpoint. So when you look at the side effects compared to placebo, they're actually very similar, other than the slight potential for increased dyskinesia, maybe about 10% or so of patients. So that's kind of a nice drug. Moving right along here, we are moving into Inbrija. And so Inbrija now has been out for a little while now, and some of you may have had some experience or may have heard about it. This is one that they're you know, kind of actively marketing. I know they've been out to some support groups and things, because I've had patients have some experience with learning about this drug. So what is it? It's an interesting drug. So first of all, it's just levodopa, and so it's almost exactly like what you're taking orally. It's just an inhaled version of it. So, and it's without the carbidopa, so it's just levodopa by itself. And basically it is something that you inhale directly into the lungs, and then it is absorbed into the lungs, through the lungs into circulation. So what does it do? It is basically used for sort of as a rescue medication. So for people who have very sudden or sort of unpredictable off times, or maybe even predictable off times, but they're not yet due for their medication. And this is something that can kind of bridge them. So it's used as needed, as a sort of, like I say, kind of rescue medication. So people often ask me, you know, how potent is it? It's about the same as taking about half a tablet of a carbidopa levodopa 25/100. So it's not very strong, but it also, you know, can be very useful. Sometimes you don't need a very strong medication. You just need a little extra bump to bridge you to that, till your next dose is either due or is kicked in. So the nice thing about it is very rapid acting. Within about 5 minutes of using it, it tends to start to produce a response in people. And so that part's nice. So, and then you can see it comes as this little gadget. And it's a bit, you know, kind of a bit like the concept of an asthma inhaler or something like that. But what you have to do is you take these little capsules and you drop them into the capsule, into the little container, and then you twist the top of the container down on it. That punctures the capsules, and then you put the mouthpiece to your mouth and then just kind of slowly inhale over about 5 seconds, and that delivers the medication into the lungs. Cough, of course, would probably, you know, logically might be the most common side effect. So if you think about, if you're inhaling something into the lungs, that might kind of tickle the airways as it's going down. And so you might have some cough. So is something that can be really minimized by doing breathing in very slowly. So this isn't something where you want to, you know, let out all your air and take as deep of a breath as fast as you can to deliver the medication. You actually want to do, you know, very kind of controlled and slowly deliver the medication. That reduces the amount of cough and actually probably enhances the amount of drug that's delivered into the system. So cough is the most common side effect. So black sputum, people see that and they go, oh, gross. If levodopa actually oxidizes like in the mouth, if you get enough kind of in the mouth itself and instead of delivered into the lungs, it can kind of turn black as it oxidizes. So it's just a benign thing. It doesn't mean anything, but some people can be alarmed if they see it. So so just to be aware of that, and it's really kind of minimized as long as you inhale it directly into the lungs instead of kind of letting it sit in the mouth. So that's that. Other side effects, not so much. So, and particularly for people who are used to levodopa, this is really just more of the same of that. So kind of a nice therapy. Maybe the biggest deal with it is sometimes just kind of carrying this around and trying to put the little capsules in there and get the thing clicked so that you can get it activated in order to use it. So that takes a little bit of time, a little bit of coordination. And some people, if they're really off, might actually need a little bit of help with that. So, all right. So that's Imbruvica, our levodopa inhaler. So now one of our newest medications, I think actually this is probably the most recent medication approved by the FDA, is apomorphine sublingual, and it's Kemobi is the manufacturer, or is the brand name of this medication. So just recently approved, and I think back in May it was approved. So just recently approved, actually not yet available commercially. So they're hoping to really launch it in, I think, September. But I think it's important so that you're kind of aware of this drug and what it does. So that you, if it's something that you need, you're asking about it as it hits the market. So one of the first questions I always get is apomorphine, is that related to morphine? And the answer is absolutely not. So it has nothing to do with opioids or pain medications. It's nothing to do with morphine itself. So it just happens to be the name because of some of the chemical structure of it. So how does it work? It is a direct dopamine agonist. So basically it is like levodopa in terms of the chemical, in terms of targeting the chemistry in the brain. It works very much like dopamine or levodopa, but it's just really a kind of a different formulation of the drug. So it's what's called a direct dopamine agonist. And the nice thing is they have formulated it to be delivered sublingually. Some of you may know that there's an injectable form of this drug, so what's called Apokyn. It's been an injectable drug, and it's been available for many years now. But people don't like to inject themselves, so they don't like that idea of having to pull out a needle and inject themselves if their medication turns off. So this was a way of getting around it, to make it as a sublingual formulation. And the kind of key to this, you say, well, that sounds pretty easy, but with this drug, it's actually a fairly acidic drug. And so what they do is they formulate it in this little nice kind of packaging. The little gel that is part of the packaging actually reduces the acidity of it and allows it to then dissolve and get into, it's sort of a buffering that happens in the matrix of this product that allows it then to dissolve nicely, get directly into the system, put under the tongue, and then get directly into the brain. So it's given as a sublingual, you put it under the tongue, you let it just kind of sit there and dissolve over a period of a minute or two, and then it kicks in very rapidly within, 5 minutes or so. So really there for rapid recovery from an off period. So it is fairly potent in terms of its efficacy. So there's doses from 10 up to 30 milligrams. So people, one of the first things about it is to have to find the right dose for people. Some people respond at 10 milligrams, some people respond at 20 or 25 milligrams. There's no predicting how people are going to respond in terms of what dose they're going to need. And that's one of the things we learned in the study. I've been studying this drug since it was first looked at. So it's hard to predict, and so because of that, we start people off at the lowest dose, and then slowly build up as needed. So what are the side effects of this medication? So right now in the United States, they're requiring that we're going to pre-medicate people for nausea with it. So people have to take at least 3 days of a nausea medication prior to using it, because sometimes initially it can trigger some nausea. Usually once people get used to it, they don't really need that nausea medication anymore, but at least initially they should have something for it. It's a drug called Tigan, I can't remember the generic name. Tigan is the brand name that is used for about 3 days prior to starting to use this drug. You can have, as it kicks in, it can be quite potent. So some people can get a little bit of lightheadedness. Sometimes yawning, it's an interesting side effect that can kind of make people yawn. Sometimes some mouth irritation. So, you know, if you're putting something underneath the tongue like that, occasionally that can be problematic where the mouth irritation is enough that it the person can't use it, but most people are able to tolerate it. So it's only a smaller percentage, maybe 10% or something that can't really continue to take the medication because of mouth irritation. So, and then the first dose has to be supervised. And what do I mean that by that? Usually have you in the office for the first dose, just to make sure that there's no, you know, blood pressure dropping, you know, with the lightheadedness and things. It just makes sure people are tolerating it pretty well before kind of sending them out with the drug to use at home. So it's a potent medication, and people usually respond pretty briskly to it. So it's a nice medication. Lasts about maybe 90 minutes or so in the system. So it's not a really long acting medication. And so you really would use it as sort of a bridge in between medications. So that's where it really has its utility is to kind of treat those rapid off periods and allow for kind of more rapid recovery in between times. So that's that drug. And like I say, coming to a clinic near you as it gets launched. So you'll hear more about that. So now we're going to switch. So that's all the main medications used for off periods. So either these extenders or sort of these rapid, either an inhaler or a sublingual medication. So now we're going to switch into dyskinesia. So these are a couple of medications used for dyskinesia treatment. So reminder, dyskinesias are those involuntary movements that you get as a side effect of levodopa usage. Most people have them over time. Sometimes they're bothersome, sometimes they're not. So this drug would be used in the case of bothersome dyskinesia. So GOCOVRI's now been out for a little while. It's basically an extended release amantadine. So amantadine's been on the market for forever as a generic medication. But this is more of an extended release, and so it can be given once daily. The idea is you take it at bedtime, and then it's available in the system by the time you wake up. So it takes about 10 hours or so for this medication to kind of kick in. So take it at bedtime. And what it does, it has a variety of different chemical reactions. One of the main things that allows it to work for dyskinesia is this NMDA blocking property. But it also has some dopamine effects. And so because of that, it can actually improve off time as well as dyskinesia. So it's a medication that can do both. So for people who are struggling with both off time as well as dyskinesia, amantadine extended release is a nice option for that. So these are just some graphs showing that this reduction in off time on the bottom left hand, the increase in on time without troublesome dyskinesia. So it's suppressing those dyskinesia. So, and then the graph above is just a graph of overall dyskinesia suppression just by itself. So it has this nice ability to kind of do both in patients. So the dosing is a variety of doses. There's 68.5 milligrams and there's a 137 milligram. So most people are going to be taking the 137 milligram, usually starting at once a day and then increasing to twice a day. So that's kind of standard dosing for it. If you have kidney problems, kidney failure, any degree of kidney impairment, then that dosing might have to be reduced a little bit. So that's the reason for the lower dosing overall. So that's something to mention to the doctor if you do have any renal insufficiency or kidney impairment, that's something will require a dose adjustment. So amantadine can be a very useful medication, but it does probably have a little bit more side effects than some of the other ones we've been talking about. So it can cause some anxiety in people. It does have a little bit more in the neuropsychiatric side effects like hallucinations. So just to be mindful of those types of things. So it can cause leg swelling. That's what edema is leg swelling. And then it also has some anticholinergic properties, which make it predisposed to causing some constipation in people and dry mouth and that type of thing. So for some people that can be absolutely dreadful and they just don't want to take these drugs. But most people tolerate it pretty well. So that is something just to be mindful of, but to not let it scare you from taking the medication. I do have to admit, we are a little bit more careful with this drug in patients who do have maybe some cognitive impairment because of the risk of the hallucinations and confusion with it. So we do have to just be mindful of that in some of our older individuals. So In addition to Dacopri, there's another brand of long-acting amantadine that's called Osmolex. So, and it's basically the same idea. It's just a long-acting version. It's the way that it's kind of formulated also provides for more extended release, so it can be given once a day. Interestingly, this one you're supposed to take first thing in the morning rather than at bedtime. So, so that's kind of the main difference for it. It doesn't have quite as much study as Gocovri, but because Gocovri has been out a little bit longer, but it is available. It might be a little bit less expensive overall than Gocovri. I think that's one of the advantages for it. So, and it has a variety of dosing, which is also maybe a nice advantage, is that you can kind of put a variety of different doses together depending on tolerability for people. So. So for this one, the cost of it, as well as potentially the variety of different doses, might distinguish it a little bit from Gocovri. So that's Osmolex in a nutshell. And then I'm going to just finish up with a couple of, before we get to our questions, so just a couple of sort of more advanced therapies in Parkinson's disease for dealing with motor fluctuations and off time. So I thought it was worth to cover these. So this isn't, Duopa has actually been out for a while now, but it's sort of an underutilized medication. And so that's why I thought I would add it in as sort of a new drug, because there might be people who haven't even heard about it. And so I thought it was worth talking about it in this particular talk. So what is it? It's exactly what you see here. So this is a carbidopa-levodopa suspension. So it comes in, so if you look at the bottom here, this little white canister here at the bottom is actually the drug itself. So it's this suspension. It's hooked up to a pump, and then the pump delivers it directly into the gastrointestinal tract. So it requires the placement of the little tube that goes directly into the stomach. That tube is then threaded down into the small intestine. It's done usually an outpatient procedure. Occasionally people might spend a night in the hospital with it, but most of the time it's done as an outpatient procedure. And then once everything's kind of settled down and healed up and people are feeling better with it, then you can start to use it. And the idea is with it, you take a cartridge of the medication out of your refrigerator in the morning, pop it in the pump, press go on the pump, and then it delivers the medication throughout the day. So this drug is actually designed to completely replace people's carbidopa-levodopa dosing for the most part. So it's very useful in people who are taking multiple doses per day. So if they're taking, you know, 5 or 6 or 7 doses per day, this might be an option for people. And those, you know, maybe those people are still experiencing a lot of fluctuations in their response through the day. And this is a nice way to sort of get around that. It requires the placement of the tube and the using of the pump every day, but has the advantage of really kind of set it and then off you go through the day without having to worry about it too much. So one of the biggest kind of downside of it is a little bit bulky, and so you see this person with a little pouch to contain it, and that has to be either put around your waist or some patients will actually have a little thing that hangs around their neck, basically a little fanny pack to contain it. So that can be a little bit of a hassle with it. But there are people who do all kinds of things with this in terms of exercising and that type of thing. So it can be associated with, you know, very normal activities despite the pump. And the reason I bring it up is it can be very effective therapy. So this is a lot of wording just about some of the studies on it, but really just to remind you to tell you about some of the study results. So it has almost the same benefit that you see with the deep brain surgery. So people who have significant on-off fluctuations where their medications just aren't controlling their symptoms well enough, those are the people that might consider the deep brain surgery. This drug actually has almost the same benefit as the deep brain surgery without requiring the brain surgery. And this was a study that looked at that, comparing it to deep brain surgery, the DBS, surgery, and basically showing a decent improvement in off time in both groups, and actually better cognitive outcomes in people with the Duopa therapy. And so I think it's something, you know, if you're starting to consider some of these more advanced therapies like the deep brain surgery, and this is something that you should put into your kind of thinking. Another therapy, and this is still very much in research, but hopefully will be approved, we're hoping by the first part of the year. This is a subcutaneous infusion. So it's the same idea as what they're doing with the tube that goes into the stomach, but this is now a subcutaneous infusion. So, and you can see this little pump down at it. So first of all, it's a much smaller pump than the Duopa pump. And then it's delivered into underneath the skin. And so this is a little catheter that's just popped underneath the skin every morning. When you wake up, you put this underneath the skin, the drug is loaded up, and then again, you press the button to start administering therapy. Studies have now been published about this particular therapy, showing that it really does have an advantage in reducing people's off time. And these were people with a lot of off time. So these were patients that were really should have been considering the deep brain surgery. And they were put into these studies and shown that they can really have substantial improvements in their amount of off time. So they were able to reduce their other Parkinson's medications as well quite significantly. So the idea is this starts to replace a lot of the oral medications that people are often taking. So side effects, it's actually amazingly well tolerated. So you can get little bumps underneath what are called skin nodules, little bumps underneath the skin that last for a little, you know, maybe a day or two after removing the catheters. And those tend to resolve with time, and you can kind of massage them to get them gone. So you might have a little bit of sleepiness with this medication, but it's generally pretty well tolerated. ICDs are these compulsive behaviors that sometimes we see with some of our Parkinson's medications. You actually don't seem to see it with this particular drugs, so some of these neuropsychiatric type side effects are actually reduced when you start to deliver medication very continuously through the day. So that's a nice aspect of that particular drug. And only 6 people in the study actually withdrew from it, suggesting that it really does have pretty good tolerability overall. So that's kind of a nice thing. And so a heads up that this hopefully will end up getting FDA approved for us. So not commercially available yet. Still finishing up on the research on it, but hopefully then we'll get approved in the U.S. So it has been available in Europe for a number of years now. So I think, you know, we're hopefully expecting that it gets approved here in the U.S. So, and then just a little kind of another heads up is there a little earlier in development, but still being developed is a subcutaneous version of levodopa. So this is a dopamine agonist, this apomorphine. But there's also a subcutaneous version of levodopa being developed as well. So just to kind of keep those things on your radar over time. So, and I like these types of therapies because they're not that intrusive, but still provide people with pretty good continuous release of their medication. So, all right. And then just the last medication we're going to talk about has absolutely nothing to do with motor fluctuations, on, off, that sort of thing. But it's a relatively newer drug. And so I thought worth just reminding people, this is pimavanserin, which has been approved since 2017. It's the first and only medication approved for hallucinations and Parkinson's disease. So, some of you may have seen some of the commercials for this particular drug. Most people with Parkinson's don't have really severe hallucinations. I think some of the marketing and things that have been done with this drug suggest that, you know, oh yeah, you're going to get these really scary, horrible hallucinations with Parkinson's disease. And that's really, you know, untrue. I think some people do, but not everybody does. But just to remind you that this drug is available and is approved to reduce hallucinations with Parkinson's medications. It's fixed dosing. You just take one dose at bedtime. Tends to be very well tolerated, which is a nice thing of some of the drugs that we use to try to treat hallucinations can have a lot of side effects. And so this drug is nice that it doesn't seem to do that. So, and what's new about it, and just this is just in the last year, is they've actually been doing studies now in people with Alzheimer's disease, dementia, for this particular drug to combat some of the behavioral changes and things that are seen in Alzheimer's disease. And they've actually shown now that it can be used and is safe in people with dementia. So that part's kind of nice too. So Parkinson's with hallucinations, but also people with Parkinson's and dementia that also have hallucinations. So, And that's a big, thing for us providers as we use these particular medications. That there have to date been a black box warning for us to say, hey, don't use these types of drugs in people with dementia. So it's nice now that the company has actually done the research to show that they can be used in that particular patient population. So, all right, I'm 3-4 minutes over what I promised. So I'll wrap up and just show you a picture of our team here at the Muhammad Ali Center. And for those of you who have been with our telehealth here for the last few months, we appreciate you, but we look forward to welcoming you back in the clinic and to all of our outreach programs and things over time. So thank you for your attention today. And I will open it up to Christina to help us with the questions.
Hey. So Dr. Schill, one of the questions was, there were a couple of them about freezing of gait. Mm-hmm. Are there any drugs currently available to help with that? Or are there any that are going to be in research for that?
Yeah, that's a great question. Freezing of gait. So for those of you who aren't familiar with it, that's when if you're, kind of walking along and all of a sudden your feet just sort of stutter step or lock up. And that can be a very bothersome symptom sometimes. And it seems to be in people who've had Parkinson's kind of a longer length of time. So strategies with it, I mean, sometimes we can just increase our levodopa dosing and that helps. But not everybody is responsive to just kind of the traditional Parkinson's medication. So the short answer is there is nothing yet approved that works really well for freezing of gait. But some of the things that we try are things like amantadine, that drug amantadine that we talked about. Occasionally that will help with freezing of gait. Stimulants, things like Ritalin and those types of medications. So might be helpful in freezing of gait. So sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. So they're things that I think can be considered in the appropriate patients. So we're actually going to be doing a study in a different target for deep brain stimulation for people who have gait disorders and Parkinson's disease. So that's a new study that we will be starting up here. So it's a tough area, and the short answer is we don't have a great therapy for people, but there are some things that can be tried.
Another question had to do with the Duopa pump. A couple people wondered, how do you sleep with that pump?
Yeah, so that's a great question. I probably should have addressed it. So the pump, for the most part, is designed to be something that you start in the morning, and then turn off at the end of the day before you go to bed. So that's how most people use it. So you disconnect the pump, you flush it before you go to bed, and then there's just the catheter that's kind of dangling out there. And so most people can sleep with that. There are the occasional people, though, that do need the medication through the night. And so that is something that we're doing with some of our patients that have that particular therapy. So it does make it a little challenging because it's harder to roll over and do that sort of thing while the pump's infusing. So I think it is a bit of a challenge for those folks for sure. But for most people, they're just using it during daytime hours.
For the for like GoCovery and Imbresia and some of the other medications that help, quickly, is there a max dose for those?
Right. So
or how often you can take them?
Imbresia and the new one, which is the sublingual apomorphine, those are both designed to be given up to 5 times daily. So I think that's what the package insert says. So for both of those drugs. So you can use it up to 5 times daily for sudden off times.
Okay. And on those off times, typically, how fast does the medications work, and how long will they stay working?
Yeah, so for Imbresia, that's the inhaled version, that's the inhaled levodopa. It kicks in within 5 minutes, starts to work. So most people feel effect very quickly. How long it lasts actually really wasn't studied in the studies, which is kind of interesting. They just studied it over a short period of time when they were actually looking at how long it lasts. However, we know it's levodopa. And so we know levodopa, if you're somebody, your pill normally lasts about 2 hours, then you would expect that this one would last about 2 hours. Or if your levodopa normally lasts 4 hours, then you'd expect this one to last about 4 hours. So it just kind of depends on how long your levodopa is normally, when you take it orally, that kind of dictates how long the inhaled or lasts. So, and then for the sublingual version, that one lasts about 90 minutes. So about an hour and a half.
And then, of course, this is a very common question. How do you deal with the cost of these new medications? Because obviously they are costly.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I'm gonna excuse myself for a minute here. I'm gonna grab you. These are all of these forms that we fill out for these various different drugs. So trying to get these drugs approved is a kind of a full-time job. We actually have a person in our clinic who's dedicated to trying to get these drugs approved for patients' programs. So, I mean, yes, there are all of these new drugs, of course, brand name drugs, and so they are often costly. So, getting authorization usually just depends on the patient. You know, most of insurance companies will require you've tried something else, and we just have to make sure we're documenting that. And then usually they get approved. They're approved as brand name medication, so there's a you know, whatever your copay for that is. So the key is first to just get it authorized, and that will hopefully at least get you coverage for it. So, and then there's often patient programs and things that can counteract. So if your out-of-pocket cost ends up being like an arm and a leg, there are also often patient assistance programs that can help out with the extra cost of the drugs. So don't let that dissuade you. A lot of the companies too offer sample programs where they will give you a month worth of the drug free to try, so that at least you can try it before you buy it. So that's something to also ask about.
Okay. The next questions actually are about Xadago. The question is it similar to Azilect, and or do they have the same side effects as like an Artane?
Yeah. Oh, good. So Xadago, that's the first one we talked about, and it is very similar to Azilect or Risagiline. However, the nice things about it is it's a reversible inhibitor, which means that it kicks in very quickly, whereas Azilect can actually take a few weeks before it really starts to work. So that, I think, is kind of an advantage for it. So it's good because also then if you're having side effects for whatever reason, you can stop it and those side effects will go away more quickly. So Artane is a different drug. So Artane is trihexyphenidyl. It's a different drug and has a really different side effect profile. So a lot of dry mouth, constipation, that sort of thing, mental confusion with that particular drug. So that's a little bit more challenging medication to use.
So the question has come up, do the doctors, will they automatically prescribe these new medications, or should the patients ask the doctor, hey, I heard about this new medication, what do you think?
Yeah, so I, you know, if you're seeing a movement disorder specialist already, they, chances are they are aware of this drug and they will bring it up to you if they think it's appropriate for you. So if you heard about anything today, though, that says, like, this is the right medication for me, I mean, I think it's fine to discuss with your doctor about whether you'd be, you know, whether it be something useful for you. So if you're seeing more of a general neurologist, they may not be quite aware, especially something that, like, you know, that was just approved a couple of months ago. So they may not have even learned about it yet. So it kind of depends on the physician and sort of the newness of the drug.
Okay. And then there is a question about stem cells. Mm-hmm. And what is going on? Do we know any research on those?
Yeah, so stem cells is still an area of research for Parkinson's disease. So, and there are a few places in the U.S. that are looking at stem cells. Columbia University comes to mind. So we're not doing anything really specifically in the Phoenix area on stem cell research. So there's a group with Scott Sherman down at the University Hospital in Tucson that has been looking at stem cell research for a long time. So although I'm not aware of any clinical trials that they're doing there, the best trial, or at least what I think is one of the better trials going on right now, is in Japan. There's a researcher there that is actually implanting patients, doing stem cell implantation in patients with Parkinson's disease, and I think they're moving along with their studies. So that would be the study to pay attention to look at the results from that. So,
okay. And then, is there any limitations with the DUOPA in what you can do activity-wise?
Yeah, so DUOPA, so that's the intestinal infusion drug. And, you know, you do have this fanny pack of things that you're kind of carrying around with you. And so you do have to be mindful of that. But patients, as long as you can kind of keep it attached, you know, close up to your body where it's not going to kind of flop around or bang around, most people can do just about anything physically that they want to do. So I've had people ask about swimming with it. So, and you can swim with it. So I have one of my patients was very interested in that particular thing because they really enjoyed swimming. And so so that's definitely something. You disconnect the pump. You don't want to take, you know, something electronic into the water with you. That would be kind of dangerous. So you disconnect the pump. What they do is you bolus yourself. So you actually give yourself a little extra dose before you disconnect the pump. And that keeps that medication circulating in your system. You go swim. And then you come back and you reconnect the pump and then off you go. So that's how it's used even in the water. So, or, you know, bathing, that sort of thing. So that can be done.
So in regards to carbidopa levodopa, with the increase in carbidopa levodopa, there's a question of obviously the side effect of dyskinesias. And then would any of these drugs that we talked about today be a appropriate replacement for those, for that?
For levodopa?
Carbidopa levodopa.
Oh boy, that's a tough one because the short answer is no. I mean, there really isn't anything as good as carbidopa levodopa to try to treat Parkinson's disease. So we can sometimes try to cut back on the dose to reduce dyskinesia. And that can often be effective if people are having a lot of dyskinesia, you know, just dropping the dose down a little bit can be helpful. However, you run the risk of now creating more off time. So now the patient's having downtime as you cut back their levodopa. So that's kind of the game that we play. And that's really the reason for a lot of these newer therapies.
And with carbidopa levodopa, there's talk about not having protein when you take it. Do any of the other medications also have any kind of limitations?
Right. So carbidopa levodopa, the idea is in order to really be effectively absorbed, sometimes protein can actually interfere with the absorption of it. So that's why we kind of tell you to take your medications on an empty stomach if you possibly can, or at least to avoid protein at the same time you're taking your medication. So do any of the other drugs do? No is the short answer. I mean, Duopa is continuously infusing dopamine, you know, you're going to be eating protein and at some point it's going to potentially interfere there, but that should be a short-lived effect overall. So the short answer is no, should be okay.
Okay. And then, we know we talked about Nuplazid for the hallucinations, but if you are already having hallucinations, should you stay away from these rescue drugs, or are they appropriate to use even though you may still be trying to treat the hallucinations that you're having?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So the hallucinations, if you're having hallucinations, I would think if you were taking something sort of as needed, that's very short acting, you know, maybe just lasting a couple hours type of thing, that you could still take that in the face of hallucinations. So I'd worry more about something more, you know, more potent than that, where you're really increasing the dose. Of medications, or that those drugs like the amantadine extended release, which we know one of the side effects is hallucinations, you know, so somebody who's already having hallucinations, we wouldn't want to add something like that on top of it. But I think most of the things we talked about today, other than the amantadine extended release, could potentially be used in people having hallucinations. It just would depend on the severity of them, though.
So as a follow-up to what you just said, so the question is, does that then defeat the purpose of increasing the dose of carbidopa levodopa for freezing if it causes the dyskinesias more? So would we, I guess the...
Just asking if freezing, I don't think of freezing as a dyskinesia. I think of that as more of a, almost like an under-medication symptom. So something that's increasing your medication should theoretically help freezing.
Okay, is there anything, all of these seem to be aimed at increasing dopamine. Is there anything in the pipeline, or maybe now, that increases the sensitivity to the of the receptors?
Yeah, that's a good question. So the one drug, which was the estradefylline, the Neurance that we talked about, that is how it works, is basically sort of increasing the sensitivity. It's working through non-dopamine mechanisms to make Parkinson's better. So that's that one novel medication. So, and they are looking at different types of therapy like that are working through non-dopamine mechanisms to really make Parkinson's better. So that is a big focus. So, yep.
Okay. All right. And so then This will be our last question because it is 1 o'clock and I want to make sure everybody gets off and I want to be respectful of Dr. Schill's time. But for those of you whose questions we maybe didn't get answered, again, we will go ahead and work on getting those answers to you so that you do have an answer. The last question has to do with CBD products and should they be taken or and do they have any effect with the Parkinson's meds that you're already on?
Yeah, good question. We can't get through a lecture without somebody asking about marijuana and CBD. So, anyway, so the kind of long and short of it is there's really been no like controlled studies on marijuana or CBD to know, you know, what are the benefits in Parkinson's disease. And so so the only kind of study that I'm aware of that has been done on it is basically it was a survey of patients with Parkinson's and saying, okay, what if you're taking CBD or marijuana, what does it help with? And the things that patients have reported are anxiety, sleep, and pain. So those are the three things that people report CBD helping with. So CBD by itself doesn't have a lot of side effects associated with it. It is not sort of hallucinogenic and things. So so that I think is a safer way to go. Marijuana, of course, is mind altering. And so you do have to be a little bit careful with that with Parkinson's.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Schill. We appreciate it. We learned a lot today. Thank you, everybody, for attending our webinar.